Dynamo here. Welcome to my den. Very impressive, hey? Oh, I do hope you like it. Hey, let me show you some of my favourite parts. Right, over here is my computer. Woo, impressed? Oh, I thought so. And look up here. Aren't my lights just the best thing? Woo-hee! Oh, and over here is my filing cabinet. That's where I... Oh, the filing cabinet. That reminds me. Hey, come on you, don't be shy. Ha-ha! Now this is my friend Slow-Mo. And that's where he lives. In the filing cabinet, yeah. Oh, don't worry, there's plenty of room. He's just a mini mate. But he is the best mate in the world. And this is just the best place to be. Isn't it, Slow-Mo? Yeah, we both have such a great time here with the games and puzzles and quizzes. But I just don't know where to begin. Hey, there are so many things to do that you may want to stop watching us and try them. So, I have made a sign. Right, when you see this... It means it's time to stop the tape and have a go in your own time, okay? So, what shall we do first? I know. I feel some words coming on. What's that, Slow-Mo? What have you got there? Oh, you know what else we have in store. Great, let's have a look. Everyone, how are you today? Come on, shout out, don't be shy. Now, anyway, I know we've only just met, you people out there, but I like you already, so I'd like to ask you a question. Do you know what a word is? Oh, you do, do you? Well, so do we. Words can be all sorts of things. They can name things, like my ball. My ball's called Kevin. Words can tell you what Kevin the ball looks like. You see? It's round. Words can explain what I'm doing. See? Here I'm bouncing my ball. Are you enjoying that, Kevin? And words can tell you how I'm bouncing it. Quickly. Or slowly. Okay, Kevin, that's enough bouncing for now. We'll play again later. Right, oh, I love words. They are great fun, and you can use them in lots of different ways. Woohoo! My favourite is when you use them to make a story. In fact, I love stories so much, I'm going to write one. In fact, I might write a whole book. Yes, I've decided I am going to be a famous novelist. A novelist is a person who writes stories and has them published in books. Okay, chapter one. Oh, what's that, Slow-Mo? What do you mean you want to listen to someone else's story? Oh, you want to listen to that story? Well, it's not as good as mine, but... Well, it's an excellent choice. Let's try and see if you can guess what will happen in the end. Oh.
As soon as Wolf began to feel that he would like a decent meal, he went and knocked on Grandma's door. When Grandma opened it, she saw the sharp white teeth, the horrid grin, and Wolfie said, "May I come in?" Poor Grandmama was terrified. "He's going to eat me up," she cried. And she was absolutely right. He ate her up in one big bite. But Grandmama was small and tough, and Wolfie wailed, "That's not enough. I haven't yet begun to feel that I have had a decent meal." He ran around the kitchen, yelping, "I've got to have another helping!" Then added with a frightful leer, "I'm therefore going to wait right here till little Miss Red Riding Hood comes home from walking in the wood." He quickly put on Grandma's clothes. Of course, he hadn't eaten those. He dressed himself in coat and hat, he put on shoes, and after that, he even brushed and curled his hair, then sat himself in Grandma's chair. In came the little girl in red. She stopped, she stared, and then she said, "What great big ears you have, Grandma." "All the better to hear you with," the wolf replied. What great big eyes you have, Grandma, said Little Red Riding Hood. All the better to see you with, the wolf replied. He sat there watching her and smiled. He thought, I'm going to eat this child. Compared with her old grandmama, she's going to taste like caviar. Then Little Red Riding Hood said, but Grandma, what a lovely great big furry coat you have on. That's wrong, cried Wolf. Have you forgot to tell me what big teeth I've got? Ah, well, no matter what you say, I'm going to eat you anyway. The small girl smiles, one eyelid flickers. She whips a pistol from her knickers. She aims it at the creature's head and bang, bang, bang! She shoots him dead.
A few weeks later in the wood, I came across Miss Riding Hood, but what a change. No cloak of red, no silly hood upon her head. She said,
hello, and do please note my lovely, furry, wolfskin coat.
Was brilliant. I love a story with a surprise ending or a twist in the tale, as we writers say. Now, what sort of stories do you like? Slow-mo likes love stories. Yuck, yuck, yuck. Oh, he says he doesn't. He says he likes adventure stories or science fiction and ghost stories. Personally, I like comedy stories. Do you know why? No, Slow-mo, it's not because I'm a joke. It's because I'm a fun kind of guy.
Hello, Steve here. My favourite kind of story is a fantasy story. Hey, DynaMo, my favourite author is Roald Dahl because I just love the BFG.
Caw! Hey, what sort of books do you like? Yeah, why don't you and your bestest friends write a top 10 chart of your favourite books? Brilliant!
I like reading Lucy Daniels stories, and my favourite one is Kittens in the Kitchen because it's the first one I read, and my favourite animals are cats and kittens.
Hi, Slow-mo, it's Kirsten. My favourite book of all time is Alice in Wonderland by Lewis Carroll.
Otis the Aardvark here, and my favourite book is called Charlie and the Chocolate Factory by Roald Dahl, and that's because it's funny and good, and it also contains chocolate.
You see, as a writer, I like all types of words. But at the moment, my favourite type of word is the naming word, like car or chair. The naming word is very useful. Without it, what would you call something?
My favourite word is gunge, because there's loads of it here on Get Your Own Back.
Yes, Slow-mo, I do know that the correct word for a naming word is a noun. Of course, I knew that. Where's he off to? What? I can't imagine a world without nouns. I mean, what would I call this? Or these? Let's all watch this and see if you know what they're talking about, eh?
Good thingy. And what can I do for you, this fine thingy?
Oh, just a thingy. I've got a thingy here somewhere. Let's see. 6 thingies, please.
What sort of thingies would that be?
Small, roundish thingies.
Farm fresh thingies for the wop, wop, wop.
That's the ones. And some thingies. Sizzle, sizzle. Delicious.
Meaty thingies that you eat with your farm fresh thingies for your thingy.
That's them.
How much?
Oh, about a thingy. And some thingy.
Oh, a thingy for catching thingies.
Oh no. A pew. Oh.
Smelly thingy. Let's see. Smelly thingy.
No.
Moo. Huh? White thingy that you drink.
Oh,
yellow thingy?
Yeah.
That you spread on your thingy?
No.
Yellow thingy that you get from the white thingy. Mm-hmm. Moo. You shake it till it's solid.
Yes.
It's smelly poo. Little thingies like it.
Yes.
You cut it into wedge-shaped thingies.
Yes, yes, yes.
Sorry, we haven't got any.
So then, how many did you spot? Right, let's take a look again. Okay, the thingy with all the things she wants to buy written all over it is a shopping list. The farm fresh thingies she wants are eggs. The meaty sizzly thingy is a sausage. And the thingy which comes from cows and you shake to make the cheese is milk. Well, did you guess them all? Oh, well done, you clever thingies.
Hey, Slow-mo, I've actually got two favourite nouns. That's hair and gel, because I wear so much hair gel on my head.
My favourite word is football because it's my favourite sport.
My favourite noun is, I think it's ants. I wonder why. Oh, pardon me.
Hey, what have you got there, Slow-mo? Oh, you've written an article for your school paper? Woo-hoo-hoo! Hey, that's given me a brilliant idea. I think that as well as being a famous novelist, I am going to be an award-winning journalist. Yeah. I'll write reports which include lots of facts and information about real things that really happen. Yay! In fact, I am going to be such a good journalist. I'm going to have my very own newspaper, and it's called The Daily DynaMo. Oh, don't look so grumpy, Slow-mo, because I have decided that you can have your own magazine called The Slow-mo Supplement. How about that then? Yay! Now, it's really important to be accurate when writing a report. Have a look at this. It's a film about a time capsule which is going to be buried under the Millennium Dome. Yeah, the Millennium Dome. That's that big tent that they're building in London. Now, watch carefully. If you could choose just five things from the items they've chosen, which would they be, okay? What do you mean, Slow-mo, here's one I prepared earlier? Wait until we've seen the film first.
On this table are the objects which will go inside the capsule, including the Blue Peter CD-ROM, a Blue Peter guide with a history of the show. There's a collection of Blue Peter badges just there. And on this cassette here is a digital copy of the episode of Blue Peter on which we launched the competition. And then in this bit here, there are things from the 1990s, including the all-important Teletubbies, and then next to them, one or two objects from the Millennium Dome itself, including roofing felt and a picture of the Prime Minister.
I made it. Whoa! And Richard, check out what's down here, because we've got 2,000 competition entries from the 12 winners and all of the runners-up. And last week, every single letter was scanned onto disc and carefully categorised by each person's name. So when anyone goes to the Blue Peter stand at the Millennium Dome, they can use the computer to access the letter while the original is buried deep below.
Clever stuff.
Yeah.
Now let's get on to our prize winners. Down here is the asthma inhaler, which was suggested by Lewis Sully. Just here, the car, which came in from James Parkinson. Another idea was to bury Roald Dahl's treasury, that idea from Jacob Dillerstone. And finally down here for my bit is My Walk to School by Tom Ems.
Here is a video of my walk to school showing how lovely it is.
All of those going inside the capsule.
I love that walk to school idea, top idea, as are this set of coins. Isn't that a good idea?
Yeah.
And Martin Palmer has kindly donated his France 98 football. It's coming home. Okay, calm down.
Silly.
We've got work to do. That's very silly. Thank you very much for that, Martin. Down here, we've got Jamie Cuthbertson. He suggested his cap scarf complete with woggle. I hope you are okay, Lizard, about that, Jamie. Ooh. And down here, Suzanne Cass suggested a set of stamps. Top idea.
This is the insulin pen, suggested by Claire Anderson. And then just behind that are these flash rollerblades, an idea from Tom Butterworth. And then just here we have a video of the Oblivion ride. That's going inside the time capsule because of Michael Davis.
Connie and I remember it well, Michael.
And finally, we have a picture of the Dove of Peace, which was suggested by Margaret Reed from Northern Ireland.
Rich, all of that has got to go in here, so let's get tacky.
Right. We had to take the capsule to the man in charge, Bernard Ainsworth.
Oh, thanks for your help, Bernard.
Yeah, no,
right, can I invite you attach it? In fact, then attach it to the chain.
Okay.
One either side and back up to the top.
Yep.
Together.
Beauty.
Press the clip at the
back. I'll do the hook, hang on.
Lift it up.
Get that in there.
Okay.
They're coming in. Ooh.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
50 years,
I know the last by anyone until 2050.
Watch it doesn't touch the sides.
Right, that's all right, isn't it? It's centre, yeah? Keep lowering.
That way a bit. And it's down.
That's it, okay, I'll release it.
Get the thing off.
There you go. Okay, take it up, thanks, mate. Right, here goes.
Oh, say goodbye.
See ya.
Big moment.
I wonder what the world will be like in 2050.
Well, at this rate, Richard, I think we're still going to be burying the time capsule in 50 years' time, so we're going to know we'll still be here.
You do exaggerate, but we'll
Richard,
get there.
I'm not being silly. This is not the way to do it.
Well, what is the way to do it?
This. See? Makes so much more sense.
Yeah, all right.
This little baby will hold 50 of our space.
All right, you were right. There we go. Job well done.
Yes, here's the 2050.
Oh, well, that was fascinating. Did you see all those thingies? Nouns. Well, now I am... Slow-mo, don't interrupt me, please. Oh, I see. You've already written down a list of your five favourite nouns or naming words, which Katie... Oh, Katie. Oh, she's so pretty. And Richard put into the capsule. Mm-hmm. Right, let's see which ones you picked. The BP guide, because you want to be a presenter when you grow up, yes. BP badges, because you really want one. Oh, don't we all? A football, because if you can't be a Blue Peter presenter, you're going to be a famous footballer. Right, rollerblades, because it's your new hobby. Great. And coins, because you need them to buy toffees. Good idea. That is a very good list. Hey, was yours the same? Or did you have different favourites? I did. Woo-hee!
Hey, Dynamo, it's Richard here from CBBC. If I could put anything into a time capsule, it'd be my yo-yo, because I'm addicted to yo-yoing. Also, some hair gel, because I wear loads on my head. And in case it's sunny, I'd put in my sunglasses.
If I was going to put something in a time capsule, I think it would be Gary the Gorilla, because he's a big bully.
Hello, it's Steve here, and the three things that I would put in a time capsule are my yo-yo, my bicycle, and my piano.
Hey, I've had another idea. Oh, goodness, I'm brilliant. I am going to write a report for the Daily Dynamo all about the Blue Peter capsule and the lovely Katie. What do you mean, Slow-Mo? You've already planned a report for the Slow-Mo supplement. Well, I'd better read it, because as the ace reporter of the Daily Dynamo, I have to make sure your report has included all the facts. Right, let's see your plan. Why it was being filled, who was filling it, when it was being filled, what was put into it, where it was going, how it was buried. Yes, if you answer all these questions, you'll have a report. You've had another idea for the Slow-Mo supplement. Oh, really? And what might that be? Ah, I see. We should make a list of the 5 things you would put in the capsule, but it could be a list of things you really like, or a list of the 5 things you never want to see again. Yeah, that's an ideal idea. Well done. In fact, that is amazing, Slow-Mo, because I was just about to suggest that myself, in fact. What? But, Slow-Mo, what do you mean I have forgotten something? I never forget things a good reporter can't afford to, you know what I mean? What do you mean I haven't mentioned the different types of nouns? Well, I hadn't forgotten. No, honestly, I hadn't. I hadn't. Look what I have here.
Nouns?
Certainly, madam. Here at Barry's Noun Shop, we have the finest selection in the country.
Common or proper?
Common, please. I'd like a hammer.
A hammer. There you go. A nice common noun.
I'd like a new name for my dog, please.
Ah, that'll be a proper noun. Certainly, madam.
Tiddles. What a lovely noun.
Of course, you'll be needing a capital letter with that.
Thanks very much. Tiddles, come along.
Tiddles. Nouns. When it comes to naming things, nothing else will do. Come to Barry's Noun Shop, 99 the High Street.
99 the High Street. Mustn't forget that. Oh, sorry, you're back. I didn't see you there. Right, so proper nouns are the names of people or special places, and they always start with a capital letter, and common nouns don't. Hey, I had another fantastical idea. Next time you're on a boring journey or being dragged around the supermarket, play Proper Nouns I Spy. Yeah, it's like normal I Spy, but you're only allowed to pick proper... No... You're not only allowed to pick your nose, Slow-Mo, you're only allowed to pick proper nouns. And don't forget, do try this at home. Dear Diary, my name is DynaMo. I'm a fantastic story writer and also a brilliant reporter. Hey! Oh, hello! I was just writing my diary. I keep all the facts of my life in here and I write down everything I do. Yeah, I was just writing how I'm a fantastic writer of stories and factual reports. Hey! Slow-Mo. Are you going somewhere? You're going to be a travel writer and write reports for the Slow-Mo supplement about animals and people who live in different countries? Hmm, that sounds like fun. Hey, if I was a travel writer, I could write about exotic animals from foreign lands. Whee! I could write about lions, sharks, polar bears, or camels, yeah, for the Daily Dynamo. Hey, camels are my favourite animals ever, ever, ever. What do you mean it's already been done, Slow-mo? What, on the telly? Oh, okay, but is it full of facts, hmm? Right, let's check. Did they mention that a camel's hump isn't full of water?
It takes a couple of weeks for a baby camel to develop humps. And they're not filled with water, as most people think. But they're actually used for storing fat.
Hmm, okay, they did. Right, well, see how many more facts you can spot. Write a list of all of them, and then we'll compare notes, as we journalists say. Catch you later.
If I told you I was about to meet a camel, you'd probably ask, one hump or two? Well, for Bactrian camels, it's two, but not always. This is Jessica, and she's just 5 weeks old. But when she was born, she was humpless. She just had two flaps of floppy skin on her back. It takes a couple of weeks for a baby camel to develop humps. And they're not filled with water, as most people think, but they're actually used for storing fat.
And when they can't get anything to drink, camels can chemically convert the fat in their humps into water. Now that's a nifty storage system. They come from the Gobi Desert in Mongolia, one of the driest places on Earth. So they have some other neat tricks to make sure they don't use too much water.
Camels are probably better suited for life in the desert than any other mammal. They can go for months without even a drop of water. They very rarely need a pee, and even on the hottest days, they hardly ever sweat. Their dung is so dry that even when it's completely fresh, it's dry enough to use as firewood. As Jessica gets older, her humps will fill with fat.
It's a bit like having your own built-in water bottle. You never go thirsty with humps.
Okay, so there were lots of facts in that report. How many did you spot? This was my favourite.
Their dung is so dry that even when it's completely fresh, it's dry enough to use as firewood.
Hey, also, as I said before, many people think a camel's hump is full of water. But that's not true, is it? No, it's fiction. Hey, why don't you name three more facts about camels? You have 30 seconds, starting from now!
Information books tell you a lot about things. I especially like ones about space.
Okay. Did you list lots and lots of facts? Hey! Yes, Slow-mo, top tiny travel writer, wants to tell you his camel fact. Go on then, don't be shy, come on. Right, I see. Slow-mo's top camel fact is, even on the hottest days, camels hardly ever sweat. Very good. Hey, I've had another idea. No, this is a really, really good idea. You'll love it. Hey, why don't you write some facts about your favourite animal or your pet?
My favourite bird is a barn owl because it has nice wings and its head is in the shape of a heart.
I'm Kate Sanderson from News Roundup. My favourite animal is a horse because it's a graceful, dignified animal with a strong personality.
What do you mean, you've had an idea as well? Oh, good, yes. Yes, absolutely, yes. If you haven't got a pet, why not make up a new creature? And you could give it a name and draw a picture of it and write three sentences about it. Yeah, great idea. I was about to suggest that.
Words ending in CK.
You got to do some spelling and you don't know what to do. There's a little man with spiky hair who's got some tips for you. Believe it or not, it's Pug Spelling Spot. When your head's getting hot, try Pug Spelling Spot.
are you, Slow-Mo? What are you doing? You're writing another report for your Slow-Mo supplement. Another one? Oh, well, I'm planning to write a report as well. I was just taking my time to get it absolutely right. Still, in the meantime, what's yours about? Oh, you mean you've written about fish? Ooh. Well, I hope there's chips as well. No, I'm going to write a report which describes something really well. It's a... Yes, Slow-Mo, I do know another word for a describing word is an adjective. Thank you very much. Now, where was I? Yes, I'm going to use words which tell us more about the way the animal looks or sounds. I'm going to pick a really exciting and dangerous animal, not some tiddly little fishy. Yes, all right, Slow-Mo, why should we write about a tiddly fishy? Because that's what the next film's about. Ah, right. In that case, I've had an idea! Let's see if we can find any really good adjectives about fish! Yeah!
They've got a reputation as the fiercest fish in the whole world. So, what sort of lunatic would get into a tank full of red-bellied piranhas? Yep, you guessed it. But actually, this isn't as crazy as it looks. You see, under most circumstances, piranhas are about as aggressive as your average goldfish. Unless they smell blood in the water, or they're very, very hungry, there's no way they'll tackle an animal as big as me whilst I'm still breathing. Still, I'm rather glad they were fed this morning.
Harry, they haven't been fed for days!
My cue to exit, I think. To see why piranhas have such a terrible reputation, you've got to catch them at dinner time.
Well then, I suppose I'd better feed them. Come on, boys. Whoa, feeding frenzy.
It's said that a shoal of piranha once stripped all the flesh off an injured alligator in less than 5 minutes, leaving just a skeleton. Perhaps it's lucky I got out when I did.
They've got incredibly powerful jaws and razor-sharp teeth. No good for holding or chewing, but ideal for just shearing off bite-sized chunks of prey. In South America, local people often use the teeth instead of razor blades and scissors. They eat piranhas too, and apparently they taste quite nice, but hey, they didn't bite me, so I won't bite them.
Okay, Mr. Clever Clogs, but you didn't say it was about piranha fish, did you? They're really interesting and dangerous. All right, yes, but nobody loves a Clever Clogs, do they? What do you mean, or a show-off? There aren't any show-offs around here. Anyway, let me show you the adjectives I've picked, hey!
They've got a reputation as the fiercest fish in the whole world.
Did you spot the adjective there? Yeah, it was fiercest. Right, time for the next fact I found.
They've got incredibly powerful jaws and razor-sharp teeth. No good for holding or chewing, but ideal for just shearing off bite-sized chunks of prey.
Yes, Slow-Mo, there were a few good adjectives in this one. Which was your favourite? Oh, you liked sharp, did you? Oh, because it's a bit like me. I see. You liked it because it described the piranha's teeth really well. Yes. See, I like adjectives because they tell you more about the noun or naming word they're with. So by putting sharp with teeth, you know more about them. Hey, how many facts and adjectives did you find? Oh, well done. That's loads. Later on, why don't you have another look at the film and write 3 more adjectives about the piranhas? But imagine that you are writing them for someone who has never, ever seen a piranha before, OK?
Hey, and to help you, Slow-Mo has some dynamic description top tips. Over to you, my reporter pal. Color. Size. Shape. How it moves. Anything unusual. Excellent tips, if I may say so. Of course, I taught him everything he knows.
My favorite describing word. I think it would be sticky, because that's what toffees are.
Hello, Dynamo. My favorite two words for describing the weather are sunny and breezy.
Slow-mo! Slow-mo, what are you doing? Ah, you're writing your life story. Oh, well, that won't take very long, will it? Sorry. So, I suppose you don't want to see what I've got then. Right, I'll give you a clue. Let's see how I can describe what's going to happen next. Yes, it's the moment we've all been waiting for. Yes, it's the bold space crusader, the bravest man in the universe, and his heroic crew of the Galileo. Their amazing spaceship. Yes, it's
The Adventures of Captain Crimson, Space Crusader. Captain Crimson and the crew of the starship Galileo were patrolling through space when First Officer Optic picked up a distress signal.
Captain, there's a mayday call from Xenthiorium 3.
Signal that we're on our way.
Chief Engineer Widget slammed the Galileo's thrusters into high space overdrive. Little did Captain Crimson realize that he was heading straight into a deadly trap. His arch-enemy, Commander Crinklian's intention was to crinkle Captain Crimson and his crew into a trillion lifeless pieces.
The starship Galileo is approaching, your crinkliness.
Now all of hyperspace shall be mine.
Captain Crimson was suspicious. The Mayday signal had disappeared. He took a landing party and beamed down to the planet's surface. Too late, the captain realized that he'd been lured into an ambush. Only the Crinklians could have caused such total devastation.
Stand by for hostile action.
Suddenly, a cluster of Crinklians sprang out at them.
There's no escape, Crimson. Prepare to perish.
The captain had a bold and daring plan. His crew could escape if he distracted the Crinklians. There was no time to lose. He quickly set the water cannon attachment on his utility piffer to hyperspin.
Take me. But let my ship and crew go free.
Why should I? I want to see your utter destruction.
The captain's plan was sheer perfection. At his instruction, the landing party leapt into action.
This will pour cold water on your plans. Go, all of you, go!
Captain Crimson was cornered. He was facing a fate worse than death. Then, something strange caught his attention.
Bring him back alive!
You'll have to catch me first.
A black hole had suddenly appeared. Nobody had ever risked going into one before, especially without a spacesuit. But it was the captain's only hope.
Catch him!
In your dreams, Crinkle Brain.
So our space hero outwitted the evil Crinklians and lived to fight another day.
Curses foiled again!
Did I mention I'm a writer? Oh, I did. Oh, I can't remember that. Well, one of the many things I write is my diary. It's where I write all the fantastically amazing, exciting, thrilling things I do each day. So, yes, Slow-mo, thank you for reminding me. My diary is full of doing words. Hey, have you ever thought of keeping a diary or a journal? You should have. It's a brilliant way of remembering things, the things you might otherwise forget.
And my favourite doing word. I think it's climbing, because I like climbing. Or maybe it's skating. Ooh, I like skating. Whoa! Oh, ow. Thank you. And that's it. Thank you. Ouch, ouch.
Why don't you build yourself a ward? Build yourself a ward with an ing to say it's happening. Take fly, add ing. Build yourself a ward. All together now. Flying, flying. Take turn, add ing. Build yourself a ward. All together now. Turning, turning. Take nest, add ing. Build yourself a ward. All together now. Nesting, nesting. Why don't you build yourself a ward? Build yourself a ward with an ing to say it's happening.
Hey, I've been thinking of things that you could be doing. Why don't you go and build yourself 10 more words using ing?
Words ending in ing.
Believe it or not, it's punk spelling spot. When you got to do some spelling and you don't know what to do, there's a little man with spiky hair who's got some tips for you. Believe it or not, it's punk spelling spot. When your head's getting hot, try punk spelling spot.
I'm going on a special assignment for the Daily Dynamo. I'm going on a steam train, yeah, with the Blue Peter team. Oh, a romantic journey with the lovely Katie. Oh. Hey, but don't tell Slow-mo, because he wants to be a BP presenter when he's older and he might get jealous. Shh. You see, in my report, I'm going to write about all the different things you can see and do on a steam train. Pick three different things people do on this journey. Roll the BP film! Oh,
The 605-32 Blue Peter is a Class A2 Pacific locomotive built in Doncaster. And 1998 is a special year for both it and the programme. Not only is it our 40th birthday, it's the locomotive's 50th. Our route was to take us via Berwick-on-Tweed, Newcastle, Darlington, York, Doncaster, Retford, Newark, Grantham, Peterborough, Stevenage, and finally, after 392 miles, King's Cross Station in London.
Thank you.
a long journey like the King's Cross run today, 60532 Blue Peter needs plenty of stops like this one at Berwick-on-Tweed to take on extra water. In the old days, they used to scoop it up from troughs between the rails as they went along. Today, it's all done using a water lorry.
Let's go over here and talk to Terry from the Preservation Society, because he's just having a look here at the wheels and everything. Terry.
Good morning.
How are you? All right?
Very well, thanks.
Good. How's she looking?
Very well at the moment.
That's good.
With a good run down. Every time we stop, we like to have a check around and make sure everything's nice and cool.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
At the moment, we're okay.
Permission to touch this?
Yes. No problem at all.
It's still a bit warm, actually. Still a bit warm.
I was watching Blue Peter when it came on the programme and it was done, and my children have watched it as well, so it's an engine we know very well. So it's great to actually travel behind it at long last, isn't it?
It's just fun, going on the steam trains. I just like steam trains.
Do you think they're more interesting than modern day trains?
Yeah, you get to see the puffs of smoke going across the window.
Said I couldn't travel on the footplate, but Peter Kirk has just said they will allow me to travel between Newark and Peterborough. It's very exciting because that's the fastest part of the journey. So I'll see you on the footplate. Wish me luck.
Well, Peter, thanks very much for letting me on here. I'll tell you what, you feel very unstable stood here. I've got a fire which is raging at I don't know what degrees Fahrenheit. Oops, sorry. And meanwhile, this guy's sticking his head out the window every 5 seconds, trying to see where we're going. It's all go, but it is an incredible feeling, I tell you.
What does it smell like?
I can't describe the smell, but it smells very strong. Like a mixture of coal and steam and a unique smell, I suppose, that you would only ever get if you were here. I love the smell, actually. Let's talk to the guy who's shoveling the coal down here. Come and have a chat with me here. Look, I've given you a rest now. I've given you a rest by talking to you. I've made Peter do all the work.
Yeah.
And he's managed to drop coal on my toe at the same time as well.
Yeah, it's very hard work.
How do they normally work in that kind of condition? They obviously can't hear what anyone's saying.
No, I know. It's very difficult to hear what you're saying. So how do you actually communicate between each other on the footplate?
Shout. Just shout.
Yeah. It's actually, Peter was saying to me, Katie, that after about 6 hours on the footplate, you do begin to lose your voice.
Keep going, Stuart.
Can you still see me?
Why do you think we sent you down there?
I'll have no voice left when I come back, I tell you.
I think the most important thing in there, obviously, is their flask of tea and coffee.
Yeah, still yet to find that.
It's right in front of you.
Where is it? I can't.
On your left.
On my left. There! It was behind me. Hey, you were going to offer me a tea or a coffee? Oh, I tell you what, you don't want to have any of that. No, I know, I insist.
It looks like soot.
Peter's just drunk it. I don't give him long. Put a bit of oil in it, adds a bit of flavour.
Come on, hurry up, we'll be out of steam.
Oh, we're going to stop.
We need a bit more, yeah?
Make him work.
Yeah. Marks out of 10. About 7, I think.
Oh, I think
he just needs. No, he's getting better. I'll give him 8. That's enough, Stuart.
Okay, we're about to go through a tunnel. Oh, I think you'll find that's my job. Here we go. I've got little enough to do as it is.
Oh. Tunnel!
That's it. That takes us into the tunnel now. Been in a black hole, I tell you. A black hole with a huge furnace behind it. Okay, now I've got a very important job because I've got to actually sound the whistle again just as we exit the tunnel. So I've got to concentrate to know where that is.
Good luck.
Okay, here we go.
Yeah!
And we're out of the tunnel. So we're approaching the stretch now where the Mallard hit its top speed. What are we hoping to do?
Just over 75.
I'll let you know when we're there. We're nearly there. 72. We're there. 75. 75
wow.
Miles an hour. We've hit it.
This is the spot.
Right. This is the spot now we're in. This is the spot where the Mallard did that speed. Peter, thank you very much for letting me come on the footplate. It's been an experience of a lifetime.
While Blue Peter was leaving York, I was 80 miles down the line preparing an ambush using a camera-carrying model helicopter. Working with the operator, Jeff Bell, I hoped to get some unusual pictures as the 532 sped by. Not quite as easy as it sounds.
In as much as the train's already doing 50 miles an hour, I have to start from a hover to 50 miles an hour, so it may just get away from me slightly, but we'll try and keep up with it as best we can for as long as we can.
How long does it take your helicopter to get airborne?
From somebody telling me, it'll be about a minute, minute and a half.
Right, well, we won't have a minute's warning, so how are we going to know when the train's coming?
Well, I think we're going to need a spotter.
Hi, Louise, can you hear me?
Yes, Richard, I can hear you.
OK, good. Any sign of our train
yet?
No, not yet.
OK, great, thanks. We've only got one chance of getting this right. If we're out by mere seconds, then the whole thing's blown. It will have been a complete waste of time. Jeff, are we going to do it?
Yes, we are. Yes,
right, good.
I'm confident.
I'm sure he'll be building his part. We'll know where he is.
We'll hear him before we see him, probably.
Richard, can you hear me?
Yeah.
It's just coming round the bend now.
OK, thanks, Richard.
The suspense is killing me. Where is he?
Hold it steady, then. Good luck.
Is it in?
Yeah, go left a little bit.
Where's his helicopter, look.
There we go. Where is he?
There he is.
Back on!
Hold it steady. Watch it. Keep it right. Keep it there. OK, start and follow. Left. Keep going. That's it. Hold it there.
Success or what?
Richard Baker!
He's right there again, he's following us in his helicopter, look.
That was him! He was waiting for our train and he wasn't even looking at us.
He was looking at his monitor because he was looking at his shot, you see.
Thanks, Rich.
Recognise these two? Former Blue Peter presenters Valerie Singleton and John Noakes were at King's Cross Station in London to welcome us with the Pandemonium Steel Band.
How lots of people making the same journey could do so many different things. I mean, the passengers looked at the scenery. Stuart was standing on the footplate, and the engineer checked the wheels. Hey, that's an excellent idea, Slow-Mo. He is going to pretend he was in Richard's mini helicopter watching the train rushing through the countryside. Hey, have another look. Can you come up with a list of 10 words which describe this view of the train?
Look at what I'm carrying, an ing.
Now I'm flying.
Well, I've stopped flying, but look at what I'm carrying, an ing. I am smuggling. For doing and remembering, be sure you're always carrying an ing.
Always carrying an ing. Hey, what's that, Slow-Mo? Oh, yes. You thought the Blue Peter film about the train was so great, and now you want to hear a story about a train? Yeah! Well, it just so happens that I happen to have the very thing. It's really fun as well. Listen very carefully and pick three really important things which happen on this train to Bonnie Glasgow.
Here is the train to Glasgow. Here is the driver,
Mr. MacIver, who drove the train to Glasgow. Here is the guard from Donnybristle, who waved his flag and blew his whistle to tell the driver, Mr. MacIver, to start the train to Glasgow. Here is a boy called Donald McBrain, who came to the station to catch the train, but saw the guard from Donnybristle wave his flag and blow his whistle to tell the driver, Mr. MacIver, to start the train to Glasgow. Here is the guard, a kindly man, who, at the last moment, hauled into the van that fortunate boy called Donald McBrain, who came to the station to catch the train. Here are hens, and there are cocks, clucking and crowing inside the box in charge of the guard, that kindly man, who, at the last moment, hauled into the van that fortunate boy called Donald McBrain, who came to the station to catch the train. Here is the train. It gave a jolt, which loosened a catch and loosened a bolt, and let out the hens and let out the cocks, clucking and crowing out of their box. The guard chased a hen and, missing it, fell. The hens were all squawking, the cocks were as well. And unless you were there, you haven't a notion. The flurry, the fuss, the noise and commotion. Now Donald was quick, and Donald was neat, and Donald was nimble on his feet. He caught the hens and he caught the cocks, and he put them back in their great big box. The guard was pleased, as pleased could be, and invited Donald to come to tea on Saturday at Donnybristle, and let him blow his lovely whistle, and said in all his life he's never seen a boy so quick and clever. And so did the driver, Mr. MacIver, who drove the train to Glasgow.
Oh, I really enjoyed that. Great. Oh, there was so much action on the train, I haven't decided yet which three things to choose. So why don't we have a look at your list, Slow-mo? Yes, I have written a list, but I want to know which three things you chose. Yeah, and so do our friends at home. You see, they're all sitting there waiting. The guards hauling Donald McBrain onto the train. The hens and cocks escaping, yeah. Donald putting all the hens and cocks back into the box. Was that Slow-mo? Did I notice anything else about the poem? Yes, of course. It was funny and... Oh, about the way the words and story sound like a train on the tracks. Really, did they? Yeah, I think I noticed it.
Here is a boy called Donald McBrain, who came to the station to catch the train, but saw the guard from Donnybristle wave his flag and blow his whistle to tell the driver, Mr. MacIver, to start the train to Glasgow.
Why not listen to the sounds you hear around you every day? Yeah, Slow-mo. Just like the clickety-clack of supermarket trolleys as they go over the floor tiles, or the sploosh-splosh of a washing machine. And you could even think of words which fit the noises. Oh, no, guess what? It's time to go already. Oh, no. Oh, well, we'll be back very soon. And while we're away, why not have a go at some of the things we've suggested? Yeah? Great. So for now, it's goodbye from me and it's goodbye from him. Goodbye. Bye. Bye. Bye.